John, thank you for coming by. In the name of full disclosure, Forbes publishes Prudent Speculator, a newsletter that comes out each month where you have specific recommendations and also some punditry and words of advice to your readers. You also manage money in, for clients and in two mutual funds, the Al Frank Fund and the Al Frank Dividend Fund.
Correct.
And about $100 million there, rest of clients about $400, $450 million.
Correct.
So no white hair yet, very good.
I'm getting some.
But going back to Al Frank, a real person, you cut your eye teeth with him. How would you describe your approach to investing? It's not quite contrarian, not quite traditional value investing. You have your own metrics, algorithms as we call them, whatever.
Sure.
Please define them.
Sure. Well, I learned at the foot of the master, Al Frank, who was a self-taught investor. You know, Al set out to learn what worked on Wall Street. And what he found is the companies trading at inexpensive valuations, low PE ratios, low price to sales ratio, low price to book value ratios, that those companies historically outperformed. And importantly, these days, companies that pay dividends have historically outperformed. So my strategy is pretty much very similar to what Al would do, is trying to find bargains. The amazing thing is that what we do is what people do in their everyday life. You know, you search for a deal. We just try to find a deal in the stock market supermarket as opposed to going to the local grocery store.
That gets to psychology. So you can define it, you look for stocks on sale.
Right, absolutely. Well, companies that are trading at inexpensive valuations, you know, over time stocks are seldom priced at fair value. They're either cheap or they're expensive. You know, our job is to try to exploit those pricing anomalies and try to buy low and sell high. It's not always
now,
easy, of course.
Universe is the Russell 3000?
Yeah, we do screen on 3,000 companies. That algorithm that you mentioned, we're always trying to find companies that fall into our parameters with our initial quantitative screens. Then once we found that smaller universe.
ADRs as well?
Yeah, absolutely, ADRs. We like to look overseas. We have about 200 stocks in our universe that we'll look at. You know, you need to have sufficient volume and need to get financial information and so forth on them. But once we've got that quantitative review, then we'll go ahead and do a qualitative review.
Now, define qualitative review, because that's where people think, okay, then the emotions start kicking in.
Well, that's exactly is something you have to guard against. You know, what we're trying to make sure is that stocks aren't cheap for a reason, because many companies are inexpensively priced, but their earnings may be heading off a cliff. They may have balance sheet difficulties. They may have obsolete products. They may have, you know, competitive challenges. So it's our job to do our homework and crunch those additional metrics. But at the end of the day, it's still a human being who has to make those decisions. So it's not a black box by any stretch of the imagination, even though we certainly rely on a lot of technology to help us get to the right pond, as I like to say, so that we can conduct our fishing expedition with hopefully a little more success.
The performance certainly of the newsletter has been pretty good.
Well, we've done well over the long haul, certainly. You know, the newsletter was launched in 1977, so the annualized return on our model portfolios is somewhere in the 17-18% range, which obviously is good. You know, in interest of fair disclosure, of course, the last few years, going especially in 2008, we could all do without 2008, and even last year was a tough year for stock pickers. So you're always not going to be able to top the charts, but we're obviously focused
on
long-term.
Hit on that for a moment. Last year, the averages looked okay,
right?
But you make the point the average stock sucked.
Well, to put it mildly, yes, there were far more declining stocks than advancing stocks on both the New York Stock Exchange and on the NASDAQ. And so last year was not a good year for the average stock. It was an okay year for the indexes, you know, the Dow Jones Industrial Average being up 8% on a total return basis, S&P 500 up a percent or two, and even our benchmark, the Russell 3000, up a percent. But the average mutual fund manager out there lost money to the tune of 3 or 4% last year. Doesn't sound that bad when you think about all the volatility and all the things we had to face last year. But it wasn't a great year. But still, in our newsletter portfolios, down a few percent. You know, we'll take it, I guess, compared to where we were, say, in August of last year when, you know, we were pushing, you know, bear market numbers for the full year.
And why is that? Why? How can the averages that supposedly measure the market do better than stocks in the market?
Well, it's simple arithmetic in that the averages are capitalization weighted. So if a handful of large cap stocks do very well, and the rest of the troops, if you will, the generals do well, but the soldiers don't, you can have a situation where the overall market doesn't do well, but the averages do it. And even so far in 2012, we've seen the same kind of thing in reverse, because the average stock this year is doing better than the benchmarks. And most of the fund managers are outperforming the benchmark this year, whereas last year they were underperforming.
In terms of picking value stocks, what isn't a value stock these days?
Well, it's an interesting question, because the line between value and growth these days is sort of blurred, because a lot of growth type companies, we own Apple Computer. And you can make a strong case today that Apple is actually a value stock, even though it's growing like crazy. You know, you have a fantastic balance sheet loaded with cash. You have a PE ratio on a, X cash basis in the 10 or 11 range. I mean, Apple is attractively priced on that level. But of course, then you focus on things like price to book value, where it's somewhat expensive. Even on a price to sales basis, there are many other stocks that are cheaper out there. So the question that you ask, though, is how do you differentiate between value and growth? And again, we try to take our initial screens, focusing on only the stocks that are the least expensive in relative to their peers, and then relative to the overall market. Then we get to do our qualitative work, and there are a lot of very nice companies that are attractively priced today. And whether you want to put them in a value box or a growth box, technically speaking, we're not as concerned about. What we want to do is buy good companies that we think will appreciate in price over the long haul, and we'll let the morning stars of the world decide which box they go into.
Dealing with human emotions, psychology, you write a lot about that. And you've made the point, as others have made, that the stock market's the only place in the world where if something's going up in price, people want it. And if it's going down in price, they don't want it. Whereas when you go to the supermarket, if it's going up in price, you look for go elsewhere for a bargain.
Exactly.
Why is that?
Well, it's human nature. I mean, it's fear and greed will drive all investment decisions. I like to say there's a pendulum that swings back and forth. We swung way too far on the greed side in the tech bubble. And then we swung way too side on the fear side in 2008, 2009, when we were sort of discounting Great Recession too, or Great Depression even. And we didn't really have such a severe economic downturn to justify that. So the emotional part of investing is something that's always there. What we try to do is to focus on market history. You know, stocks have delivered the best long-term return relative to bonds and bills and inflation.
What about people like Gary Shilling, who say since 1981, bonds have done better than equities?
Well, it depends what you're invested in, Steve. with our returns of 17, 18% a year, that's better than what bonds have done. And certainly that's why I think stock picking matters. Because you can't just buy an index and sit with it forever, because the indexes are going to, at least from my perspective, going to contain many stocks that are not attractively priced. And so I think you can be buying undervalued stocks independent of where the overall market might be, keeping in mind, of course, that if everything is expensive, then it's your job to obviously have more cash in your portfolio. But these days, I think everything is more on the cheap side than expensive, especially given where we are on interest rates. But the fact that interest rates are at such low levels is a sign of that fear. I mean, people are willing to pay to get one basis point, 0.01% on a money market fund. And that's where a lot of money is parked. Or they're gonna shovel money into US Treasuries, where a 10-year Treasury yield is microscopic as well, 2% or so. So I mean, those just aren't attractive yields or returns from where I sit, especially when the dividend yields on stocks are so attractive.
Was it just the trauma of 2008 that, as you put it, people focus on return of principal instead of return on principal?
Well, I think it's a culmination of things. You had, you had what happened in the tech bubble bursting, right?
Right.
And you had 9/11, which obviously caused market break. You had 2002, which was an awful year. You already had a slowdown going on in 2008 in terms of corporate profits and the economy, and then it was exacerbated by, the financial mess. Absolutely, it's a combination of things. And when you see the kind of volatility we've seen with, and this is an important part, with the 24/7 media coverage, the fact that you can look at your smartphone and see what your portfolio is doing at any given second, I think that's a good thing for informational standpoint, but it's not a good thing for the emotional part of investing. And then you throw in what happened also with most asset classes all going down in 2008 and 2009, including your house, you know, the value of your house, you know, the value of your art, the value of, you know, your fixed income investments, unless they were in treasuries, you know, went down. So you had a combination of factors that really scared the bejesus, if you will, out of everybody. And it takes time for those wounds to heal. And you'll see the investors poking their head up out of the foxhole a little bit now. But we certainly don't see, despite the rally we've seen off the October lows, we don't see any signs of greed really emanating out there from the average investor.
So this isn't, in your mind, a suspicious rally? The volume is low, as you point out. Mutual funds, equity funds still aren't taken in very much compared to bond funds.
Right. Being a contrarian when it comes to the overall market, I like it when there are a lot of skeptics out there. I like it when there's not a lot of enthusiasm toward equities. That makes me feel better that equities are going to do well going forward. And so I'm really focused on a lot of those kinds of factors. And so today, with mutual fund flows actually being negative out of equities into bonds, people are still shoveling money into bonds. That's a positive from where I sit, even though the average investor is now sitting here saying, I just missed out on an 8, 9, 10% rally, and I'm sitting here getting nothing in my money market or very little with my fixed income investments. Maybe it's time to tiptoe into stocks. And that's why I'm focusing more on dividend payers and even in the larger cap space, because I think that's the next stop for investors as they come out of their foxholes.
Even though the small stocks have done well this year?
Yeah, even though small cap stocks have done well, and of course we have those as well. But I don't think that the big money, the real money, the pension fund money, the hedge funds are still very much skeptical of this rally. I just don't see the real money coming into equities yet. And when it does, I really think it's going to focus on the bluer chips, the stocks, because of course they're still going to be very scared and they want to make sure they have that liquidity to be able to get out if, you know, something blows up in Europe or there's some other traumatic event. And so there's going to be itchy trigger fingers out there, and I think that large cap stocks provide a level of safety for those kinds of investors.
Dividends, even though we haven't seen a big flood of money, it seems like everyone says, go with the big ones. J&J yields more for the first time since the 1950s. You find tons of stocks where the dividend yields more than the bond,
right?
8 or 5 year, 10 year bond. Do you feel uncomfortable that others are echoing you?
I want to be the guy at the party that nobody wants to talk to, believe me. So I do have a little bit of discomfort over the fact that a lot of folks are talking about dividend paying stocks. But I think they're talking about them for one reason and one reason only in their mind is, well, you get a yield. You get income, and that income is greater than what I'm going to get on a fixed income investment. But what we've done in our analysis and looking back at market history and our own studies is that found that dividend paying stocks have actually delivered better returns over the long haul than non-dividend paying stocks, and believe it or not, they've done so with lower volatility. So I think there's additional reasons over and above what the masses are doing as far as dividends go. And so I think the theme of dividends has legs. I think that most companies these days are paying dividends. I mean, heck, we're going to be talking about Apple maybe coming out with a dividend. You know, Microsoft, Cisco, you know, all the big names are pretty much paying dividends. It's in vogue. If you look at the S&P 500 last year, you had, you know, over half of the companies raise the dividend or initiate a dividend. So dividends are here to stay, so to speak. And one final point on the subject is that if you look again back at market history, 25 to 40% of total return over the long haul has come from dividend income and dividends reinvested. And yes, there's still capital appreciation in there, but you don't want to ignore dividends. I think you do so at your peril. And I don't think it's a crowded trade, even though a lot of people are talking about it, because I just don't see the mutual fund flows. I don't see people shoveling money, you know, at stocks. I see them nibbling. And of course, in the first part of the year, you have, you know, flows from, you know, retirement contributions. And I think one other point that people might have missed is that you have rebalances that are going on among asset allocators, because last year fixed income investments did well and most equity investments did poorly. So a lot of folks are selling down some of their fixed income and putting it into equities. And so that has played a role, I think, in the rally that we've seen thus far this year. But I do not think that the dividend theme is overbought, so to speak.